y'all. Hey there, Wooster Naz, Pastor Joel here, and it's time for your weekly update. First, we need to talk about the Big Serve. On Saturday, April 20th, we have the opportunity to make a huge impact in our community. We've committed that morning to partner with different groups around Wooster to make a difference for the kingdom and for them. We will also be taking on some tasks here at the church as well. But we need a big showing of people to make this happen. So we're asking for your help. You can check out the info for the Big Serve on the events page at WoosterNaz.org. You'll see all the different tasks that are available that morning, allowing for you to sign up for the one that fits you best. Then stay for a lunch and time of fellowship together where we will have a great time. So we look forward to getting our hands a little dirty as we serve side by side on April 20th. And next, starting today during second service, so you can still make it if you want to, we will be offering the class Biblical Citizenship. Biblical citizens require a knowledge of biblical principles and how to apply them to the world around us. So join us for this 8-week class that Rick Geething will be facilitating to learn how we can be a part of the catalyst for restoring biblical values in our neighborhoods, state, and nation. And then on Sunday, April 21st, we will be celebrating baptisms during both services on that morning. I get so excited just thinking about those that have made a decision for Christ and want to be baptized to testify to that decision. If you're desiring to be baptized, just go to WoosterNaz.org/events and get signed up. The more the merrier couldn't be a more accurate statement when it comes to baptisms. And finally, the semi-annual Too Good to Be Through sale will be happening this coming Saturday, April 13th. Too Good to Be Through is a ministry that provides kids gently used clothing and toys and et cetera to families at resale prices. You can check out the details of the sale and also see if there are any volunteer spots left on the Wooster Naz events page. Man, there are so many great things going on around here. To find out about everything that's happening and all the details that you need, check out our website and go to the events tab. And if you're new to us today, would you stop by the Connect area on your way out and give us a chance to get to know you? Or you can go to the website and click on the I'm New tab and fill out the Connect card. Because around here, we believe everything rises and falls on relationships. God bless, church, and have a great day. Hey there, Wooster Naz, Pastor Joel here, and it's time for your weekly update. So I've been practicing my ventriloquism. Pretty impressive, isn't it? Yes. It's been a long week of practicing, but I finally got it down. No, it's good to be together once again. Hope you're wide awake this morning. You've had your coffee or your Mountain Dew, whatever you need to get in the spirit of worship. Man, it's a lot of things going on here. We could be doing announcements all morning long to let you know some of the stuff that's going on. But one additional thing that I want to add, if you're sitting near the end of your rows, you might see that there's these plastic bags. And those are what we call crisis care kits. Within the Nazarene denomination, what we do is locally, at all the local churches within the denomination, we collect these crisis care kits, and then whenever there is a disaster of some sort, an emergency need, they get sent to those areas where they're needed. And it's just basic items that we take for granted each and every day. And so what we're asking you to do is to partner with us and to take a bag, take two. If you're sitting near the end of your rows, take those bags, send them down the rows so everybody can grab one or two or however many you might be willing to help us out with. But what we do here locally, we take one of these bags. There's a little insert in the bag, and it tells you exactly what is needed to be put in that bag. It even says on this form, if I could read it. I can't read it, but the word exactly is in there. I know it is. And I know it's a broken record if you've gone to church here. If you're new to us, just humor us here for a minute. Because what happens is you all are generous people, unbelievably generous. And you want to add things maybe that aren't on the list that you think should be. Or you want to put two or three of something where it says one. If you want to do that, just take multiple bags, okay? Because when you don't put exactly what's supposed to be in the bag, somebody here has to take those things out and rearrange it, okay? So you think you're being generous, and you are, but you're creating a little bit more work. So we take a bag, we put exactly what's on this list in the bag, return them here, and then we get them to our district headquarters, and then they move them on, and then they get distributed as needed around the world. And so you get to play a part in people being helped, people being served in very difficult times. So those are at the end of the rows. If they don't get passed down, or if you need more, there's some in the back. You can see one of the ushers. They will get them in your hands. All right? All right. Well, let's pray for a moment real quick. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity for us to gather in this place like this, yet on another Sunday to worship you, a beautiful morning that you've given to us. So we pray your blessings on this time together. And Lord, it's all for you. And so we pray that it puts a smile on your face as we lift our voices in song, as we hear from your word, as we fellowship with one another, as we give, whatever it might be, Lord, they're all acts of worship to you. And may you be glorified through it all. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. I'll invite you, if you can, if you're willing to stand as we begin to worship this morning.
Your breath. we pour out our praise to you only. 'Cause you are worthy of it all. Yes, you are. You are worthy of it all. Oh, Lord. For from you are all things, and to
Incense arise, God, day and night, night and day, let All creation. your name is highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, but your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy. Could tell a story. If my life would sing a song. If I have a testimony. If I have anything at all. It's no one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me on this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered o'er the earth, let it be known in you alone my joy was found. Let my children tell their children. Let this be their memory. Oh, all my treasure lies in heaven. Jesus, and you were everything to me. Jesus, his faithful hand has held me on this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known in you alone my joy was found. Found.
Can anybody declare that this morning with confidence that nobody ever cared for me like Jesus? Man, I know that's true for me. Maybe you want to come this morning as we pray. Maybe you need to cry that out, what we just sang in that song. You're still enough. You are still enough for me. Surrendering all. Maybe you need to come and kneel this morning. Some have already done that. But let's enter in as we pray this morning together. Well, Father, as we are in your presence this morning, we find ourselves just with hearts of thankfulness and gratitude. As we celebrated last Sunday, you are the risen King. We thank you, Jesus, for your blood poured out for us. We thank you, Father God, that as we read the story of the Bible, from the moment of creation to the time when sin entered the world, every other part of the story is up, bringing us back into relationship with you. So we thank you, Jesus, for making a way for eternal life. And this morning, Lord, we declare that you are worthy of it all. You are above all things. You go before all things. You are in all things. So this morning, we just say thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for walking with us, even in maybe some of the hardest moments of our lives, Father. You know every situation that's going on in our lives this morning. Those that are here, those that are watching online. Lord, I pray that the reality of your Holy Spirit would be so real to us this morning, that we would know, we would have confidence that you are with us, walking with us, that we are never alone. Father, I pray where healing is needed this morning, I pray that you would touch and you would heal. We thank you, Jesus, that by your stripes we are healed. So we thank you for moving and working in that way this morning. Lord, I pray for those that are walking through the valley, that have recently experienced the loss of a loved one, or maybe it's been a year or 5 years and that pain is still there. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would come and be our comforter and our hope, that you would be the lifter of our heads. this morning, Lord, we together stand in unity and we just rebuke the lies of the enemy. We know that he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to tell us that we're not good enough, smart enough, we don't have enough. All of those things are lies. Because with you, Jesus, we have strength and power. We are overcomers. We are more than conquerors. So we thank you, Jesus, for your power. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace for us. We thank you for all of the blessings that we have in our lives. So many good things. I pray that our normal response to that would not be, man, look at me, look how good I'm doing. But our natural response would be, look at what God is doing in my life and through me, that we would point in praise to you. As we have the honor and the opportunity this morning, Lord, first to return the tithe and then give above and beyond that, I pray that you would continue to work through the generosity of your people here at Wooster Nazarene. You are doing incredible things through your people here. So we thank you that we get to be cheerful givers. We get to be a part of you blessing our local community and people around the world. So we pray that you would continue to move as we are faithful to give. We thank you, Lord, for Pastor Nathan, and pray that as he comes to share this morning, that our hearts and minds and ears would be open to hear. And that this morning we would maybe reach a new tipping point of that living, transformed life. That you would be moving us and taking us deeper in our relationship with you, that you would be revealing things to us that we need to surrender to you this morning. So we pray for your anointing on Pastor as he comes to share. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are moving and you are working among us. We pray all of these things together. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Well, as I was greeting a lot of you, I saw lots of smiles, but I saw lots of tears. And it reminded me of the song that Stephanie wrote that we sang, and she was probably thinking of this. I grew up with this. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind and true. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. That's for somebody today. You need to know how much he really cares for you. And I think you've come the right day at the right time to receive an encouraging word. As I work through the crowd, I'm just aware it helps me to be aware of who's here and all the emotions that are going on. They are great and they are varied today. This really helped me. Very early this morning, I got a text. I don't normally read these, but I felt like I should today. Listen carefully, and this will tie right into what I want to say, I believe. Now, I'm not a science person. I'm reading this with permission, by the way. This seems to be a pretty big deal. Once in a lifetime, for sure, schools closing, government's offices are closing, and seems some towns are shutting down for a portion of the day. Reminds me of a time in the Bible when there was darkness over all the earth. Not just if you were in the path of an eclipse, it was when Jesus hung on the cross, literally carrying our sins, dying for us. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land, it says in Matthew 27:45. And it was not an eclipse. It was a supernatural act of God to draw attention to what the sun was doing. The sin was so great that God had to turn his back on his own son. That's why Jesus asked, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" It's hard to wrap my mind around it all. His act of love for me, his great suffering, darkness for 3 hours in the middle of the day, God's provision. I am definitely going to take a look at this eclipse tomorrow with glasses, of course. And you know what I'm going to be thinking about? Jesus. His love and suffering and obedience and the pain of the Father and the Father's love and darkness and sin. Because like the moon tomorrow will come between us and the sun, our source of light, my sin comes between the source of light. Jesus is the light of the world. In him there is no darkness. I am thankful for this once-in-a-lifetime event to remind of Jesus and his work. And it is not lost on me that this is all occurring 1 week after Easter. He is risen. How do you know that a week after Easter, he's still risen? That's the good news that we have. That's the hope. So I'm going to do a couple more messages about Easter impact, because I think we're too quick to see Easter in the rearview mirror, and I think we need to see it through the windshield. How about you? Because Easter has, not past, but has a huge life-changing impact for sure on the disciples and followers of Jesus, but for us as well. The resurrection changes everything. It touches everyone. I want to read some scripture in John 20, verses 19 and on for a few, maybe with comment. The same day at evening, being the first day of the week when Jesus rose, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. In other words, they were fearing for their lives. The followers of Jesus knew what it was to deal with uncertainty and fear. And wouldn't you know, at that moment, Jesus came and stood in the midst. That means in the middle. And said to them, "Peace be with you." Could I code it? I'm here. I'm peace. You have it because you have me. When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. In other words, that was a point of identity. They knew it was him because of the scars. So Jesus said to them again, I think he's trying to get that message to them and to us today. He's not only saying to them, but he's speaking through the ages. He's telling us today, peace to you. That's the message I want you to get today. I am with you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they're forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. And I won't read verse 24 because that gets into Thomas. And I want to say one more message about Thomas, because Thomas are us in a lot of ways. Toys are us. Okay. I know. I don't know if they're anymore. So here's the thing. Jesus kept but keeps showing up right in the middle of life circumstances. Is anybody glad about that? I want to say it again. Jesus keeps showing up. And not only past tense, but he's doing it and he will do it again when we need him most. Because how many of you agree the middle can be tough? There's a lot of you that are in the middle of it, a lot of stuff. I felt it today. We don't fly a lot, but we fly from time to time. Dixie and I did. And I just want to ask you, when you fly, who in here would be brave enough to say, I absolutely love and look for the middle seat on the airplane? Why? Okay. Who likes the window seat? Come on. If I can get your hand raised on this, it might help later. No. Who prefers the aisle seat? Yeah. Well, when Dixie and I last flew, it was to Florida, February, March, and we flew Breeze Airline. I mean, every other week there's a new airline. I guess the planes were good. But I liked it because when we walked on the plane, on the right, it was A and C. We thought we were going to be split up. The only thing not sitting in the middle is have somebody sit in the middle by you that you don't want to sit by. Come on. That takes up more than their share and hogs both armrests. You know what I'm saying? But it was only A and C. It was ideal for us because no one was in the middle. I was thinking there's an old song, a rock song, I think, Stuck in the Middle with You. I pulled that up on Spotify. I know some of you are thinking about that right now. Do I need to sing a line? No, you just pull it up in your mind. But in many cases, we don't like to be in the middle, but that's exactly where we find ourselves, in the middle of circumstances, and we draw our conclusions that we talked about last week from the circumstances we're in, and that almost always creates a problem. Because when we go circumstantial, it's never good. Right. We often feel stuck. Now, wouldn't you agree? I mean, the start is exhilarating. Oh my, we're full of energy. And the end, if we get there, is a time of celebration. But the middle is where we can tend to get bogged down and get stuck. And that's where many of us find ourselves today. Stuck in the middle, not with you, but maybe feeling alone. The start is exciting. I mean, you know, we throw up a whiteboard and we brainstorm and we write every conceivable idea on that whiteboard. Everything's on the table. I mean, many outstanding ideas are given birth to in those moments. It's a combination of ideas. We're better together. I love those times, but it's in the middle when things begin to require action steps towards implementation. We find that in our staff gathering, staff summit. We love to brainstorm. We love to evaluate an event that just happened and find out what went right, what went right, what went right. But new ideas along the way, somehow they have to get traction, and it means work. In the middle. The real work begins in the middle, below the surface. A lot of times the infrastructure out of sight. But I'm here to tell you today in a positive sense, so much happens in the middle. And I want to say it's all good. And it's all used by God. Because he's at the beginning and he's at the end and he's in the middle. Alpha and Omega and all things in between. That's a word for you. But in the middle, many times things begin, often begin to get difficult. We've got to again step up and do things, take action to what needs to be done. And I could do so many case scenarios that I know a lot of you are in right now, and it feels like the middle. But here's the challenge of the middle. It's when you feel equally far from where you began, but also equally far from the finish line. Isn't that the tension? This is when we feel most tempted. That's when we feel like giving up and quitting. Because our want to tends to wane and our feel like it tends to dominate, that's circumstantial, and that leads us into problems. One of my favorite stories in the Bible, and I have a lot of them, is in Nehemiah. And that was, I won't give all the background, you can read it, but it was about where Nehemiah got on his heart a burden to go and rebuild the wall that was so torn down around Jerusalem, it was disgraceful. And he did. I mean, God was with him and gave him favor in so many ways. But in chapter 4, verse 6, it said, listen to this, my point. So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. I mean, starts are glorious and grand, aren't they? But isn't it interesting that it says to half its height? I mean, they were going strong. And this Bible story ends with they rebuilt the whole entire wall in 52 days. But in the meantime, it started with a bang and it ended in flourish. But in the middle, they got bogged down because in Nehemiah 4:10, it says, then Judah said, the strength of the laborers is failing. There is so much rubbish or trash that we are not able to build the wall. They were ready to quit and they're ready to turn on their leader, Nehemiah. Because we got to blame somebody when the project stops and we get stuck. But it was in the middle of that stuck point, that sticking point, in the middle of that challenge that Nehemiah declared these classic words, I love it, I love it, I love it, in Nehemiah 6:3. So I sent messengers to them, this distraction, with this answer. I am doing a great work and I can't come down. Oh my, some of us need to put that up on our wall or on our mirror. God has called me. He's placed me for such a time as this. I'm doing a great work, and I will not be distracted. I will not come down. I don't want the work to stop while I leave to meet with you. It was an enemy of the people of Israel anyway. The people of God hit a wall, so to speak, in the middle of rebuilding. They felt like giving up, and morale was running on fumes, and Nehemiah had to lead like never before. Have you ever gotten stuck in the middle? Have you ever been inspired about this time of year to clean out your garage? So you I was good at this. You take every single thing that's movable out of your garage, and you're going strong, and then about a couple hours into it, you start shoving everything back in the garage because it was more than you thought it was going to be. After all, we know that garages aren't really for parking vehicles in. You may need a storage unit, in fact, to hold the extra stuff that won't fit in your garage, especially if you live in Florida with no basement. It's the middle that gets us many times. It's in the middle. It's in the middle that we're most tempted to let fear overtake us and overwhelm us. I was thinking about a couple of storms that the disciples were in on the Sea of Galilee, and in Matthew 12:14-24, it says, but the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, and the wind was contrary, and they were overcome with fear. In the middle, I mean, it started out great, they were gonna go to the other side, but in the middle, that's when things got tough. That's when the boat rocked. In the middle, they began to lose heart and lose focus. These seasoned, we can't just read this story, these are seasoned seamen. I mean, they thought they were gonna die, they thought they were gonna drown. I mean, if the captain of the ship is concerned, you better be concerned too. But Jesus showed up, because that's what he does. Jesus showed up in the middle of the storm. In the middle of their stuck feeling and their fear-filled lives, those life circumstances were overwhelming. He showed up when they had all but given up. And so we tie it to the story of post-Easter, I'll call it, in John 20:19, the same day, I'll read it again at the evening, being the first day of the week, because that's when it all began, the count up. You remember when the doors were shut, when the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst. Just think of that. He came and stood in the middle. I'm so glad he didn't say he looked in the window, looked in the door, that he came and stood off the side. He said he showed up right in the middle. Is that encouraging to you? He comes to where you are, where we are. And what did he say? He said on the water and other times, don't be afraid, don't be afraid, but it's my peace to give you. He said it again, peace be with you. He said it twice, it must be important. The disciples were hunkered and huddled down behind those closed doors, locked and barred, thinking they were gonna be arrested at any moment. I talked about it last week as accomplices of Jesus. They were expecting someone to pound on the door and break it down. They were at great risk at that point. In those exact moments when they didn't know what to do, Jesus showed up. He came and stood in the middle of them and says to us through the ages, peace to you. Peace to you. And you know what? I have a feeling, and I've experienced it, and I think many of you have as well. I talked about standing by my mother's coffin when I was in college after she was killed instantly in a car accident. And if I know anything of that experience, and I can still close my eyes and be back there, I can see her body lying in state, broken that it was, and I can remember an all-surpassing peace that I could never have explained, but his peace guarded our hearts in Christ Jesus. I felt, honestly, like Jesus was right there beside me. This is tragic, a horrible circumstance, but I want you to know you're not alone. I'm with you. And you know what I found looking back years later when I went back to college after the J term and people were awkward, they didn't know what to say, but I found that peace is a powerful testimony because nobody can explain it away. You may not be able to explain it. It comes from the inside out. It's not circumstantial. It's peace that goes through any circumstance. It's the peace that Jesus gives. And I just want to hone in on that for these final moments together. Because I believe that Jesus is still showing up, and not just for his disciples, but he's still showing up for you and yours. Be encouraged today. Well, he's not showing up for me. No, he's there. You may have not seen him. You may not recognize. You may be looking over here. You're looking for the front door, and he can walk through walls. I mean, before you know it, if you look for him, he'll just show up where you are. What I'm trying to say is this, first of all, that when he shows up, comfort and calm, peace come with it, but his presence makes all the difference. In this world, in our culture, where so many people are so lonely, isolated, it's good to know that we're never alone. I find it interesting, don't you? And I was just thinking about Jesus showing up there with the disciples post-resurrection. We're post-resurrection. And think about it. There were 10, right? Where was Judas? You know? Where was Thomas? Who knows? Could somebody do a study and tell me where Thomas was? I want to know. But there were 10. But when Jesus showed up, there were 11. 11's a majority. Did you know that? But the good news is this. You may think you're alone, but you're not. When Jesus shows up and when you recognize him and acknowledge that he is Lord, there won't just be one, there'll be two, and two's a majority as well. Because he's with you. He's looking for you. He showed up. He showed them his hands and side, it says in 20:20 of John. Many of us who are parents or grands have had the experience of our child being one of our children or grands being frightened in the night. And it isn't amazing the difference our presence makes when we call out, when we go in the room and we touch them and we speak to them soothingly and we calm them. Isn't it amazing how things can change in a hurry? And then we toss and turn and are tired in the morning as they sleep peacefully the rest of the night. Oh, God love them. He'll get back at them when they have children and grands. He'll pay them back. But the presence makes a difference. Things were different for the disciples and different for us when we have a Jesus encounter in the face of rising persecution that was coming at them. They stood strong and bold. The ones that were ready to cut tail and run, turn tail and run, they stood strong and bold. They refused to back down from their testimony because they knew Jesus is alive because he showed up for them. They counted it all joy to suffer with Jesus. They didn't count it all happy. They counted it all joy that they were worthy to be identified with him. Acts 4:18, but I'll just skip to verse 20 of that section. Here's their boldness. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. What were the things? Jesus showed up after he was dead. Wouldn't that rock your boat? Peace be with you. Oh my. They were different because Jesus showed up. And that's still true. When we say yes to a relationship with Jesus, yes, and come into relation with him, we have the promise of his presence at all times. Matthew 28:20 says it at the C part. You can be sure of this being C. I am always with you to the very end. Does anybody believe that? That's a statement by faith because we can't always see him and we can't always feel him, but we receive it by faith because Jesus said it and he's the one that had the wounds in his side. He's the one that experienced everything and he said, I am always with you. Are you going to take that to the bank or not? It'll never bounce, that promise. Where Jesus is, there is peace because he is peace. Ephesians 2:14 speaks to it. It says, verse 20, 14, Christ himself is our peace. So if you don't have peace today, I want to ask you, first of all, do you have a right relationship with God? Not just do you believe in Jesus, do you know there's a God and all that, but I mean, have you opened your heart and say, come in this house, come in this heart? That's what it takes, because when Jesus comes in, peace comes with him. Jesus, you can come in, but please leave your peace outside because I want to be filled with anxiety for a while. I just really like to worry, I like to fret. No, he says no. I can't because I am peace. If you take a spoonful of me, yeah, there's love and all, but there's peace. If you put it on the microfilm, fish, whatever, there's peace. My friend Andre, that I've never met, wrote, my peace I give to you in a world that is filled with confusion and fear. I looked it up and listened to it. My peace I leave with you. He wrote again, I will keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stayed on me. Peace is not the absence of trouble or pain or suffering. Hear me. It's not the absence of loss. There is, listen, if you only catch one thing today, there is peace of his presence in the middle of trouble and pain because Jesus is peace and he is here because Jesus keeps showing up. Amen. That's how any and every, I say those words with measure, carefully. That's how any and every circumstance can be offered as a sacrament of the present moment, as an old timer once wrote, Lord, I give this to you. Palms up. Because the disciples experienced him, his presence, these young heroes of the faith stood up in boldness and courage, and they were fueled by that presence. And I pray that this is true in our generation, and I'm encouraged now for middle schoolers and high schoolers and college students and young adults. I believe God's raising up a generation for such a time as this that are compelled and propelled and powered by the presence of God. Is anybody buying into that today? I believe it. I believe there's a move. God's plan for all of us is to overwhelm circumstances and difficulty with his goodness, his presence in people like us, consumed with his great love and living in the grip of his grace. I think Charles Swindoll wrote that, a book, or maybe Max Lucado, I don't know. Oh, could you write this on the flyleaf of your mind? His presence can calm any storm. That's point A. But the best part is this. His presence can calm you in any storm.
Thank you, Lord.
Could I say that again? His presence can calm any storm. His presence can calm you in any storm. Has anybody experienced that? I mean, it's turbulent. But his presence brings peace. I'm moving quickly, not just his presence, but his words. Jesus didn't talk too much. He didn't speak first. He asked questions and he listened, but he spoke just the right words at just the right time. And they were so calming, so comforting. When he said in John 20, 19, see again, peace be with you. He's still speaking those words. I want to tell you, the living words of Jesus weren't just spoken long ago. They're still echoing through the corridors of time. If you look for him, if you listen, you'll hear his words spoken to you because he loves you. Their circumstances didn't change. They had lived in grave danger, and a lot of their original fears would come to pass because they would all, nearly all, except for John, be martyred. But the resource of his peace changed them forever for the rest of their lives. Do you think it was just for them? It's for us. Words can calm the storm, remember? Peace, Jesus said to the storm, be still. I don't think it was peace, be still. I think it was peace, be still. My parents used to tell me to be still, but it wasn't peaceful. His words can calm you. We hear the word shalom, and we know that they mean, in the Hebrew sense, they mean that that's about wholeness and well-being that comes from God giving you every good gift. I mean, that's what God speaks, peace to you. He's with us. He's for us. So could I challenge you this point? Let's determine, let's decide by God's grace, held in the grip of grace, not to wait until it's over to worship and celebrate God's goodness, his generosity. Let's choose to give God praise and glory right now. It's not just pray now, it's praise now. When's praise always appropriate? Now. When's worship always appropriate? Now. I mean, you can do that in an instant. Wow, that's the anchor to our hearts, his word. Well, here's another one. His wounds are comforting. Wounds? I couldn't come up with all W's, but his wounds are comforting. Some of you remember, so many new people, but for 8 consecutive seasons down at the other campus, we had what we called Easter ministry, and we didn't vary, and I think the reason it was so powerful because it touched so many lives because we didn't vary from the biblical story of Jesus. We didn't run all these side stories of what might have, could have happened. We kept the focus on Jesus. And somewhere along the way, Kathy, our departed friend, not departed from this planet, but departed from this place, she wrote in just a few moments the song Wounded Healer. And that's a phrase that, again, I've run across in antiquity. Somebody used that phrase, I don't even remember who. But that sounds so ironic and sounds like a contradiction, but it's not, because He's been there. He suffered. When he showed us his wounds, that changes everything. He's saying, you're not alone. I can identify with you, and here's the wounds to prove it. I'd tell you to look that up on Spotify, Wounded Healer, but I don't know where it is in the atmosphere. We'll have to find it and play it sometime. I don't know that it was ever published, but it was a good one. Go back to John 20:20 again. It said that he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. In other words, that was a point of identification for him. You know, sometimes when a body's deceased, they come and have you identified, and you identify them by what you see, what you recognize. Well, it was the wound. No, it wasn't just a ghost or something. It was Jesus. And when they saw him, another translation said they were exceedingly joyful at seeing him and hearing his voice. Unmistakable, proof positive, it was the risen Lord. They were convicted and convinced for the rest of their lives. In Luke 24, it tells the same story beginning in verse 36. Here he shows up, I'm skimming. May peace be with you. Surprised and terrified, they thought they were seeing a ghost. Jesus said in 38, why are you troubled? Why do you have doubts in your mind? Look at my hands and my feet, touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have a body or bones. You can see that I do. And I find this, I smile when I read God's word. Things just tickle my funny bone. But they still didn't believe. I mean, okay, give them a break. It's hard to be critical of them. Put yourself in their situation. They were amazed and filled with joy. So Jesus asked him, do you have anything here to eat? Give me something to eat, he said. They gave him a piece of cooked fish. He took it and he ate it in front of them. So it's not just, my favorite verse isn't just Jesus wept now, it's Jesus ate. That changed. That was key in them really coming to a belief. He ate in front of them, the Bible says. I love those little nuances of scripture. And by showing him his wounds, I think Jesus is saying parenthetically, I came through the other side. It's not over. Everyone that says yes to a relationship with me and loves me is going to come through the other side too, because this is not all there is. They were comforted by his wounds because the last time they saw him, they represented the worst thing that had ever happened. But to me, the wounds, the healing wounds, the wounded healer, it's the idea that he plans to reconcile everything at the proper time. He's not done. I was thinking of this. Have you ever thought about this? You remember when Moses, the great man of God, I mean, a humble man before God, was such a great leader. God used him so much to bring his people out of captivity. And then after all that, because of blatant act of disobedience, one thing, when he did something that he shouldn't have done in regards to the rock, God said, you won't enter into the promised land. Did that ever make anybody else sad when you read that? I think, that's when I go, that's not fair. No, I'm the only one that reads that way. But then I got thinking about it. You know what? Where did the Mount of Transfiguration happen? In the promised land. Who was there? Moses showed up. So I don't have to feel bad for Moses anymore because he did get a second chance. He did get a glimpse of the promised land. He was there. Don't you love how those loose ends tie together? He showed them his wounds. You thought your life was over. You thought your dreams were shattered, but I'm just getting started. Even death couldn't hold me. I am restoring all things. Will you let him in your life? Look what I've done. I've given you peace in the storm. I'm not taking the storm away, but I've given you peace, a promise of an eternal relationship with me and heaven too. Take courage. Be confident in me because I am peace. And I am in you if you're my child. And then he said, I'm going to give you a work to do. And that's important because we all need significance. He gave them a mission in 2021. It says, Jesus said to them again, peace to you. As the Father has sent me, so also I send you. In other words, get your eyes off of yourself, focus on me, and focus what I have for you because the best is yet to come. I know you've suffered. I'm not minimizing your loss. I'm not saying it doesn't matter, but I'm going to use you in a more powerful way. I'm going to strategically place you where your testimony can impact other people because the storm you're in, because I've spoken peace to you in the storm, and your life is a testimony nobody can deny. We're his ambassadors. What a privilege. We're now his representatives in the world. And I'll call this the next level living when it comes to significance and joy. What a privilege. And could I remind you that we're strategically placed as well, and we're on a mission to be his representative as well. We're his transport system, if you will. And Romans 10 says it so succinctly, and this was a passage that the Lord dealt with me when I felt like he called me into preaching ministry out of full-time ministry, but to specifically preaching. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear him about him unless someone tells them? That's us. And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That's us. That is why the scriptures say, how beautiful are the feet and messengers who bring good news. What? The good news of the gospel. Jesus is peace. He is with you. He wants to live in you. When we gather in his name, there's peace and calm and comfort. We're on a strategic mission by God to populate heaven and to plunder hell and populate heaven. I think, wasn't it, that Friday night in worship, the last song, a phrase was, hell has lost another one. I am free. I am free. The good news. So it's not only praise now, but how about peace now? Huh? Peace now. Win now. And then finally, quickly, there's the win. And I did get some W's going. I did that for my son, Nate. He doesn't like it when I put all the words that match. But the disciples were calmed by his spirit. And I just would point out this quickly in John 20 that he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. And then I referenced that to Genesis 2:7 because scholars tell us that the same words used. He said, and the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. That's what Jesus breathed on them. It's his spirit in us and over us that changes everything. Well, I have to land it. So Jesus was crucified with the text I started. I hope that'll be a prompter for you to think about our sin coming between us and a source of light. I hope that'll sink into your heart. Right there. And there's that middle word again, because he was in the middle between two thieves. Agreed? This dark situation, Jesus was right there in the middle of it. And he paid the sin debt for everybody for all time, including the thieves hanging beside him. But here's the problem. One rejected, but the other accepted. And Jesus said, today you'll be with me where I am. We can be right with God because Jesus hung in the middle. Is anybody glad Jesus hung in the middle? He didn't just do it for the thieves. He did it for you. He did it for me. So wherever you may find yourself today, emotionally and spiritually, I'm not making light of any of it. Jesus is speaking life to you. He's speaking life over you, present and eternal. He wants to be in the middle of your life, in the middle of your storm, with his peace and comfort, and calm you. He may or may not take the storm away. But that's not the only testimony. Would you open your heart and life and go palms up? It's your choice. God's looking for you. He sees you. He loves you. He's calling out your name. And he's saying to you, I want to be peace to you in you. I want you to be forever with me where I am. But that only comes to a relationship where we say yes. Jesus died for both thieves. Did he not? Are you agree with me there? But only one thief experienced eternal life by receiving what he had done. Well, Easter impact beyond the day we celebrate is about Jesus showing up where one becomes two, where 10 becomes 11. And he's looking for you. He's knocking again on the door of your heart again. For some of you last week online and here, he was knocking on your door, but you declined to answer the door last week. He's looking for what? A personal invitation to him, saying, Jesus, come in this house. Come in this heart. I need your peace. I need to know your presence. I need to hear your words. I want to see your wounds. Have you ever extended him a personal invitation to come in to your heart and life? I was thinking about this. The middle is a big deal to us, but it's never the middle for him because he lives in the eternal present tense for now, past, present, future. I mean, it's like right now, he's here. And he's peace in our middle of whatever. And he brings us great comfort in the middle of our circumstance. But I want to tell you again with emphasis, peace of Jesus begins with a relationship. His peace isn't going to rub off. His peace comes in and changes everything. I'm going to invite you to stand, if you can, quietly. Thanks for being so attentive today. Right where you are, you have another opportunity to go palms up. And that's just a great position for any kind of an invitation, a response, invitation to a response, saying, Jesus, I want to receive what you've done. I need your peace. I wonder how many in this crowd and online would just say, I really need the peace of Jesus and I don't have it because I am in the middle of it. I am stuck. Would you look to him? Would you check, how's your relationship with him? Have you said, yes, I receive what you've done by faith. I choose to believe. I'm so sorry for my sin and my selfishness. I'm turning from that, and I'm turning to you, and I'm giving going palms up. I'm giving you my sin, but I'm also surrendering myself to you completely. I want to say it again. Peace of Jesus begins with a relationship. As we conclude, I think we got a little song to sing, wrapping up, but our altars and stairs are always up. I just encourage you to keep using the altars and stairs. Why? Because we have so many guests and new people, and they're not going to use them unless we're comfortable in doing that. So if you need to pray about peace today, if you want to receive Jesus, if you've made that decision in your heart, if you said yes to him, you need to tell somebody. Sometimes you need somebody to pray with you or help you. You want to pray alone, it doesn't matter, but I would invite you to come. Or if you're just struggling and you need peace today, you can come and be seated at the altar or at the stairs. You can pray alone, pray with somebody. But would you just respond as they sing this simple song? After I pray, Jesus, these are precious people I've had the privilege of speaking to today, not only filling this house and these rooms around us, but online as well. And I pray for a release of peace that is beyond understanding. I pray that you would be the calmer and comforter of people in the storm, because I know there are a lot of legitimate storms going on, but you've promised to be with us. And if we haven't seen it yet, that means we maybe haven't need to see what we think we do, or it's on the way, but you're working. So we just say yes to you. So could you be the comforter of every heart? Could you just go up close to that person that's struggling so much and put your arms around them and embrace them and hold them and whisper peace, peace in the storm? I pray it confidently. I pray that people would have the courage not to just have their emotions touched a little bit, but to say, Lord, I need peace. I don't have it. I've been looking, running around a cul-de-sac, looking for peace, but it's elusive. But peace is a person. It's you. And I say yes to you, to a relationship with you right now. Jesus, I give you a personal invitation. Come in my heart. Live in me. Live through me. I'm yours. I'm yours. Would you lead us? If you know the song, sing as an act of worship and surrender today. We'll conclude with this. Again, the altars and stairs are open. If you're just struggling today, if you need somebody to pray with you, just need to bring a burden to the Lord, please do. Please do. Just come forward and lay it down. Say, Jesus, I need you. Cry. Some things are worth crying about. I need you, Jesus. I'm bringing this burden to you. I'm bringing me to you.
This is my desire.
You know it? Sing it along. Right now, in the storm, I choose. I'm in a storm. I'm asking for your peace to calm me right now, right here. You're real. By faith.
It's all I have within me. I give you.
That's a right now choice. Will you make that choice right now? Maybe you just need to raise your hand where you are. It says your testimony. Say, that's me, Lord. I find it in you. I'm looking for you. I'm listening for you. I'm watching for you, Jesus. Sing it out. Sing it out.
Lord, I give you my heart.
It's what he's looking for, a personal invitation. Come in. Come in. Come in today. Lord, I pray.
And this is my desire.
Palms up, Lord.
To honor you
in all things.
Lord, with all my heart.
Yeah.
I worship you.
That's your choice today. I choose you. To choose him is to choose peace. Raise it now. Come on. Let's all raise it as a testimony. Our testimony corporately here. Lord, I give you.
Lord, I give you.
Right here,
heart.
Right now, I give you.
Give you my soul.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
I live for you, Lord.
Every breath that I take, every moment,
every moment.
Thank you, Pastor Nathan. Wasn't that a great message? So practical, so tangible, and so needed in this day. Well, as we go today, be warm, be loving. Take time to fellowship with each other. Don't forget, we had the crisis care kits on the roads. If you want to grab some of those on your way out, please do so. But it's been so good to be together once again. God bless you all. Take care, and we'll see you all soon.